Welcome. Thank you guys for coming today. I've been asked to speak this morning on heresy in the early church. And that means I have about 50 minutes to cover approximately 200 or 300 false doctrines. And that's not possible. So we're going to hit some of the high points here. I want to begin by discussing the nature of heresy in the early church. There's a lot of different understandings of this word heresy. It's thrown about quite a bit in our day to describe, in some cases, anybody who disagrees with me, what they believe is heresy. And that's not really a helpful definition of this term. We need to define it a little bit more precisely. And essentially, if you want to boil this down, put it in a nutshell, heresy is false doctrine that strikes at the heart of the Christian faith, that destroys something vital to Christianity. There are false doctrines, we were discussing these a moment ago, that are on more peripheral issues. We can debate amongst ourselves as brothers and sisters in Christ over eschatological issues, the millennium, its nature and its timing. But when you get to something like who God is, denying the Trinity, denying the deity of Christ, denying salvation by grace, those kind of things strike at the heart of the Christian faith and would fall under the definition of heresy. So when we're talking about the nature of heresy in the early church, we're looking at doctrines in the early church that struck at the very core of what it meant to be a Christian. In some sense, the story of the early church is a story of heretical isms. I mentioned there's dozens and dozens, really hundreds of these false doctrines, and they're continuous. It's one right after the other when you're looking at the history of the early church. If any of you have ever read early church history or studied this in school or elsewhere, you know that it's a history of isms, and they just keep coming. And one of the things we need to think about when we look at how heresy arises and how it can be something helpful for us, presumably you came to listen to this because you think there might be some value in knowing what heresy is, and I think there is, and heresy can serve a purpose in the church. Over in the fellowship hall, you're getting hearing about a lot of truth. In this class, I have to tell you about a lot of falsehood. So it's kind of a strange thing, but learning what a counterfeit $20 bill looks like is just as important as knowing what the real thing looks like. And that's part of what we're doing here. In the early church, Jesus, before the ascension, did not hand the apostles a copy of the Nicene Creed or the definition of Chalcedon. These statements that the church uses to explain the boundaries of Orthodox Trinitarianism and Orthodox Christology don't come into existence until the middle of the 4th century and the middle of the 5th century. What's going on during those hundreds of years prior to that is the story of orthodoxy and heresy, but it's not a matter of the first apostles having a copy of the Nicene Creed and then they're being attacked. That took time. What we have can be described, I think, in a helpful illustration of this is the church is walking along a path. They've been given this doctrine by Christ. You have the witness of all of the Old Testament, the witness of the epistles and the gospels and the book of Acts and so forth, all of the biblical witness testifying to who God is and who Jesus is, and the apostles are proclaiming that and teaching that in the churches, and over time they're writing letters and gospels and so forth teaching this, and the next generation of Christians, they have this collected witness. And as they move forward, they're trying to understand, because questions are arising. You're taking this witness out to, well, you're taking it to the Jews first and then to the Gentiles. And the Gentiles, they're coming from a pagan background, and they hear you saying that you believe in one God, and yet they also hear you preaching that the Father is God and the Son is God and the Holy Spirit is God, but the Father's not the Son and the Father's not the Spirit and the Son's neither the Father nor the Spirit and so on. What do you mean? That's the kind of question they're getting. So as the gospel went forth, as this proclamation went forth, questions arose, and sometimes the answers that were given were wrong. And sometimes as the church was thinking about this, as they progressed along this path towards the 4th and 5th century culmination of these debates, sometimes they're walking along this treacherous mountain path and trying to explain these things, and one Christian will say, well, I think I have a good idea about how to answer this question, and they take this side path, and suddenly you hear this scream of somebody falling off a 1,000-foot cliff and and being destroyed. There's Sabellianism. And a couple of, you know, then somebody else, a few steps later on, he'll say, that looks like a safe path to how we'll answer this question about the Trinity. Scream, 1,000-foot cliff. And the church says, okay, that's not a safe path. Let's put a fence up here. And then the next person takes a false heretical path, and the church says, let's put a fence up here. And gradually, as you're moving along, you're learning all these wrong ways of answering these questions about who God is and who Jesus is. And eventually, they got to the point of putting together, and this obviously is oversimplified, but in the midst of these debates with heretics, Arius set the whole forest on fire, and you end up with the Nicene Creed basically saying, here's what we believe is what the Bible teaches about God, taking into account all of the biblical witness about who God is, about the Trinity, and who Jesus is, and we're drawing these barriers. We believe that all of these paths are dangerous paths that lead to destruction. Then the topic changes a little bit. We know we have a good statement of our doctrine of the Trinity, but how do we explain who Jesus is? Some of the things that the Gospels describe are things that are only true of God, and yet other things that we see in the Gospel, only a man can do that, and yet there's only one Jesus that we see in the Gospels, not two. So how do we explain that we have one Jesus, and sometimes he's doing things that are only appropriate to God, and other times doing and saying things only appropriate to a man? And so another couple of hundred years until you get to Chalcedon. Okay, now we have a statement. Here's what we believe is a statement of who Christ is, that what the Bible teaches, that takes into account everything. All of those false heretical trails, in one way or another, are failing to take into account everything. With the Trinity, they either overemphasize the oneness and don't take into account the threeness, or they don't take into account the distinctions between the three. Or on the person of Christ, they take into account he's one person, but don't deal with the two natures, or take into account two natures, don't deal with the one person. So I want to start with the earliest heresies and just move chronologically. I thought about a few different ways to approach this, and I think chronologically, given the illustration that I'm providing of the church moving down a path and gradually seeing which answers to these questions don't work, a chronological approach seems like it might be the best. Heresies were not a surprise to the early church. We were warned, the apostles warned about them in the scriptures. We read, for example, in 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 1, false prophets also arose among the people, just as there will be false teachers among you who will secretly bring in destructive heresies, even denying the master who bought them, bringing upon themselves swift destruction. Now, there are a number of topics this passage raises. The one I want to focus on is the prediction of false prophets, false teachers, and heresies that are going to be brought in. This is written by one of the apostles. This is part of the New Testament. So we're in the first century, and the apostles, there's no golden age. It's not as if the church managed to make it through a couple of hundred years and everything was rosy, and then it was only when Arius showed up, you have heresy. They start at the beginning. They start even at the time that Scripture is being written. At the time Scripture was written, we had already dealt with the Judaizers. Hope you like my wolf in sheep's clothing picture I found. But the Judaizing heresy that Paul deals with in the book of Galatians, this is something that Paul said struck at the very heart of the Christian faith, that if anybody, an angel from heaven, an apostle, anybody brings you any other gospel, let him be what? Anathema, accursed. That's serious when an apostle of Jesus Christ is saying, an error on this point means you are anathema. That is heresy. And the Judaizing heresy, as you recall from reading Galatians, you had this group of Jews who were saying that because the first Christians were all Jews, you had the apostles who were Jewish, and the ministry, the gospel of Christ is initially going out from Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria, so mostly a Jewish audience. Not that there weren't Gentiles here and there who would have heard this, but it's primarily Jews at the beginning. And then as Paul's ministry and others go out farther out to the edges of the Mediterranean, what's now Turkey, Dr. Hagin was talking about Cappadocia, and to North Africa and East, Gentiles begin to come into the church. And you recall there was a group among the Jewish people who were saying, these Gentiles cannot come in and become Christians unless we have them circumcised. In essence, they have to become Jews first before they can become Gentiles. And you know what Paul's answer to that was in Galatians? Absolutely not. There is now neither Jew nor Greek. We are all one in Christ. And we are justified by faith, not by circumcision, not by keeping the works of the law. It's true of neither Jews nor Greeks. There's one way of salvation and one people of God. And keeping this wall up and keeping this barrier up between Jews and Gentiles strikes at the heart of the gospel. It's a works. To have them be circumcised is inherently a rejection of justification by faith. There was also another heresy that we see even in the pages of the New Testament, docetism, or based on the Greek word dokeo, to seem. There's not a great illustration for this heresy, because this heresy is basically saying that Christ's humanity was not real. He only appeared to be human. Well, how do you, number one, a lot of Christians have objections to images of Christ in any sense, but it's even more difficult, even if there were no qualms about that, how do you do an image of an unreal human being? You'd have to have an image of some kind of ghost or phantasm or something like that. But this was the idea that Christ's humanity was not real, his sufferings were not real, and it was based on an ancient assumption that you find throughout the Greco-Roman world of the time, that matter is inherently evil. The material world is inherently evil. This was part and parcel of the Gnostic heresy, which we'll talk about momentarily. So this idea that matter is inherently evil is held by Gnostics, which was the heresy in the early church, the biggest one in the earliest centuries. And it's held by people like Marcion. Marcion held this docetic Gnostic view. He rejected the whole Old Testament. That's the main thing he's known for. His canon of scripture was basically the Gospel of Luke and 10 epistles of Paul, altered to fit his theology, of course. But he rejected the rest of the Gospels as being too Jewish, rejected the entire Old Testament. And he also rejected this idea of Christ's true incarnation. And we see this addressed, I believe, in the epistles of John. If you recall 1 John chapter 4, verses 1 to 3, the apostle writes, "Beloved, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God, for many false prophets have gone out into the world. By this you know the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is from God, and every spirit that does not confess Jesus is not from God. This is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you heard was coming and now is in the world already." Normally in class, I would make some comments about what he said about the Antichrist, but the main point here is that the denial that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh, what later theologians called docetism, is how you identify somebody with Antichrist theology. So if you want to see Antichrist in the early church, look for the Gnostics. Look for those who are teaching a docetic view, a denial of the real incarnation. Speaking of Gnosticism, I mentioned this was probably the greatest heresy in the first couple of centuries of the church. It took some time to deal with this, and it was a multi-headed heresy. A hydra, if you will, and it existed in numerous forms. There was not a single Gnostic doctrine. You can't just look up and say, what is Gnosticism? Well, it's this one thing. There were various Gnosticisms. There were various teachers holding to this kind of thing. It seems to, there's dispute about this among scholars, but it seems to have originated among some of the Jews in North Africa who had been Hellenized and who had been affected by Platonic philosophy. And it resulted in that type of Platonic dualism interpreted and morphed together. That was mixed together with Judaism, with the late first century BC Judaism, and became these various forms of Gnosticism. So it was a syncretistic view. It was trying to blend Jewish views with pagan philosophical views, and it led to just multiple streams of this. Some of the main points of Gnosticism, I mentioned dualism. That's the key thing. There's dualism in connection with their idea of God, dualism in connection with their idea of man and with the world. God, their dualistic view of God, there is this transcendent, supreme God, but he didn't have anything to do with this world. He exists in a realm of pure light, completely alien to this world. There is a lower deity who's responsible for creating this world, a disobedient lower being, a divine being who did this. The true God, the exalted God, is not to blame for this mess. And in most Gnostic systems, you had all of these semi-divine beings, intermediate beings between the one true God and the God of the Old Testament who created this world that we live in. It takes a mind that doesn't mind being driven to insanity to enjoy reading about Gnosticism and to enjoy reading Gnostic writers. It's weird. That's the only way I can describe this. So God is split. There's a dualism that leads to a sort of polytheistic view. And then human beings are also split. There's a dualism in humanity. My true human self is this spark of the divine that's consubstantial, identical in nature to the one true God, but it's trapped in this physical human prison of this human body. Now, if I asked you to raise your hands right now, and how many of you have heard anybody in recent years in your lifetime teaching anything like that, I imagine most of you would raise your hands. Gnosticism is alive and well today. You don't hear the word that often. But this view that our inner human self, this divine spark that needs to be reunited, is imprisoned in this evil material body still exists today. How do we become free from this? Well, it's through knowledge. The Greek word for knowledge is gnosis, and G-N-O-S-I-S, and that's where we get the word Gnosticism. The means of salvation is through gnosis. The transcendent God sends a messenger to those of us who are trapped in this world, of this evil material world. And in the Christian heretical views, the Christian heresies that were Gnostic, guess who the mediator is that this one divine sent, this lesser deity that he sent is Jesus. Jesus is this subdivine intermediary who's sent to give us the true gnosis, the true knowledge that we are a divine spark, and it's this secret knowledge that's not available to everybody. You have to have the secret handshake and the password and everything, and then you can get the secret knowledge that will allow you to be free from this evil world and this evil material body and be reunited with the divine God. So there's a world of light and a world of darkness. In this material body and material world, we're in this world of darkness. We need to be freed from it. We can only be freed from it through this secret knowledge. And then we will be in this reunited into the transcendent God. And the church had to fight tooth and nail against this. Irenaeus's great work against heresies is devoted to fighting Gnosticism. Tertullian, one of the other early church fathers, fought against Gnosticism. If you were a Christian bishop or pastor at that time, you had to fight against this. And if Gnosticism had won the day, and I don't believe it could have because God is sovereign, he promised to preserve his church, but had it won the day and that doctrine taken over, the Christian faith would have been annihilated. It struck at the heart of the Christian faith on the creator creation doctrine, the who God is. It identified the Old Testament God not with the true God, but with a different sub-deity. Gnosticism also had this strange way of couching all of this doctrine in these super elaborate myths, the strange mythological language, and that's one of the other things that makes it so bizarre. You have reinterpretations of the biblical material into really strange mythopoetic forms that really don't make sense in any normal logical way of thinking. I don't encourage you to go read them. It's just, they're strange. If you're interested in Gnosticism, of course, know what it is and you can read them. But if I had time, I'd read you some passages from the Gnostics and I'd see a lot of wrinkled brows and puzzled faces because it's a strange thing. So for the Gnostics, matter is not merely imperfect, it's evil. What does that do to the incarnation? Can the Son of God assume a human nature and a human body and if you believe that matter and any contact with matter is inherently evil. No, and that's what led to the docetic view that the Gnostics held. It can't be a real incarnation because a real incarnation involves carne, flesh, a body, and a body's evil. So they denied the incarnation. What does that do? That, again, strikes at the heart of the Christian faith. Moving on, I want to mention another early first century heresy briefly. It's known as the Ebionite heresy. This is exactly the opposite in a sense. The Gnostics denied the true humanity of Christ. Ebionites denied the true deity of Christ. And this builds on, these were also, according to the tradition, Ebionites were Jewish people who believed that Jesus was the Messiah. However, their definition of that was that he was a mere man who had been adopted by God as his son. He wasn't the eternal son of God, but he was a son in the way that the Old Testament prophets were sons. So he was a human Messiah, and only a human Messiah, a normal man. He became the son of God by fulfilling the law and being obedient. Now, a developed form of this teaching will be found in the next couple of centuries among those who are technically known as dynamic monarchians. We'll get to that strange term in a little bit. Or adoptionist, but it's an early undeveloped form of adoptionism, this idea that Jesus is not eternally the Son of God, but he's adopted, he's a normal man who is adopted as the Son of God at his baptism or at his resurrection due to his fulfilling the law and being obedient. This takes us to the second and third century. And the second and third century heresies, you have to recall, these are taking place during the time when the church is still under persecution. It's harder for them to address these heresies as they will in the fourth and fifth centuries in ecumenical councils, because the church is not only having to deal with enemies on the inside, heresies, but they're also trying to stay alive and fighting enemies on the outside, persecution, not only by Jews, some Jews that are still left at this time haven't been dispersed, but Romans as well, the Roman authorities, since they were an illegal religion, as Dr. Haken was saying. One of the most important heretics, I've mentioned his name already, was Marcion. In addition to being a docetic who denied the incarnation of Christ, the true humanity of Christ, he's known again for rejecting the Old Testament. Basically, complete discontinuity with the Old Testament and with Judaism. He's saying we have nothing in common as Christians, and the Old Testament is not our scripture. So it's a rebuilding of this. He also denied that the God of the Old Testament is the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. So he's interpreting the Old Testament in a complete, there's a complete dichotomy and complete discontinuity. I have to kind of move through these. I apologize for that. Monarchianism. I mentioned dynamic monarchianism a moment ago, but during the second and third century, we have this view. If there's one thing that almost everybody agreed on who understood the scriptures, it was God is one. And there's one ruler, one source of all things. So mono, from mono meaning one, arche, ruler, source. There's one source, one ruler. And so you have this idea of monarchianism. It's starting with the premise of the oneness of God, which is a good place to begin. We all affirm monotheism. We're all monotheists who believe in one God. Yet we know as Christians that Scripture also is testifying that the Father is God, the Son is God, the Holy Spirit is God. So how do we deal with that? Well, there were two forms of monarchianism that arose. One, dynamic monarchianism, also known as adoptionism. I mentioned this in passing in connection with what we were talking about earlier, but in this view, Jesus is not the eternal Son of God. He's adopted, thus the term adoptionism, as the Son of God, or his resurrection, or his ascension, depending on which adoptionist you're reading. A second century teacher who advocated this view was Theodotus of Byzantium. Third century advocate, whose name you run across a little more often than that, is Paul of Samosata. He said that Jesus achieved the status of being adopted as the Son of God by keeping himself free of sin. And in his view, this idea of logos or word is an attribute of the one God. So you have this one God, monotheism, who has this attribute of reason or logos. And that attribute indwelt this ordinary man, Jesus of Nazareth, and by means of the Logos indwelling him, and he became the adopted son of God. But this wasn't anything incredibly unique. The Logos had indwelt the prophets of the Old Testament. He had indwelt the kings and the priests and so forth because of their anointing. So let me read a brief quote by Paul of Samosata and give you an idea of where he's going with this. He says, "The Savior became holy and just, and by struggle and hard work overcame the sins of our forefather. By these means he succeeded in perfecting himself, and was through his moral excellence united with God, having attained to unity and sameness of will and energy with him through his advances in the path of good deeds. This will be preserved inseparable from the divine, and so inherited the name which is above all names, the prize of love and affection given in grace to him." That's a far cry from our understanding of Christ, that Christ was a man who had to perfect himself and work to achieve this status of perfection. So we can see why the early church, the Christians who were trying to take seriously all of what Scripture taught, why they rejected adoptionism and dynamic monarchianism. However, this wasn't the only form. Modalistic monarchianism, or Sabellianism, or more simply, modalism, was another form of monarchianism, starting with the idea of one God. Again, a good starting point, but not if you ignore the other testimony of Scripture. This was taught by teachers such as Noetus and later Sabellius, where it gets the name Sabellianism. According to this view, there is one God who, in the works of creation and redemption, expresses himself in different modes. So in the Old Testament, he expressed himself in the mode of Father. In the New Testament, the time the Gospels describe, he expressed himself under the mode of the Son. After Pentecost, he expresses himself in the mode of the Holy Spirit. But it's all the same one God. In a sense, you have one actor wearing three different masks. So you have God putting on the Father mask, and then later taking the Father mask off and putting the Son mask on, and then later taking the Son mask off and putting the Holy Spirit mask on. And this is what we're getting at with modalism. This, I believe, is probably one of the more common ideas you'll find among average Christians, even in the evangelical church. If you ask them, "Explain to me the doctrine of the Trinity," a lot of times when I've done that, modalism is the answer I get. And so this still exists. Even, you know, people don't, if I ask, when this happens, people don't say, "Well, I hold to a Sabellian view or a modalistic monarchian view." They will just tell you, "Well, I think a good way of thinking about God is that God sometimes shows up as Father and sometimes as Son and sometimes as Holy Spirit," as modalism. And this, too, is a problem because it takes into account the oneness of God, but doesn't take into account that by which he is three. It doesn't take into account the fact, it takes into account two of the three aspects of the biblical witness. God is one, check. The Father is God, the Son is God, the Holy Spirit is God, check. The Father is not the Son, the Father is not the Spirit, the Son's neither the Father nor the Spirit, the Spirit's neither the Father nor the Son. That's where they go off the rails, because there is a distinction also in Scripture between those two. Jesus is praying to the Father. If you're a modalist, that's a very bizarre thing. How does that work? That's Jesus on his knees in the Garden of Gethsemane praying to the Father and then taking that costume off, turning around here, and now he's the Father answering himself. It just doesn't make any sense whatsoever of the biblical witness that we have in Scripture. So modalism is one of those dangerous paths that had to be dealt with. One of the terms that they were accused of, and you'll sometimes run across, you'll hear this word patripassianism, which is a fancy theological word that means the Father is the one who died on the cross. You've heard it, the passion of Christ, his suffering on the cross. Patri from the Latin for Father. So patripassianism, the Father suffered. Tertullian accused modalists of being patripassianists because if there's only one God and the Father and Son and Holy Spirit are the same, then the Father died on the cross, the Holy Spirit died on the cross. The Son, it was the one God who died on the cross, and it doesn't really matter that Scripture says it was Jesus Christ. Now, when we get to the 4th century, things really take off in terms of the nature of the heresies we run into. One of the most important heresies after Gnosticism that had enormous significant influence on the church is Arianism. This is an old depiction of Arius at the Council of Nicaea. Arius is right here. This figure is St. Nicholas. And I don't know if you can see this, but St. Nicholas is depicted as smacking Arius upside the head. Now, we all know who St. Nicholas in popular culture is. Santa Claus is who he's become in our culture. This is my Santa Claus. He's taking out Arianism. He's taking out one of the major heresies of the early church. So you can have your jolly elf. I want the guy who's taking down Arius at the Council of Nicaea. Let me summarize briefly. Arius, the Arian heresy and the Arian controversy is a strange thing because Arius arose in the early 4th century. He had a dispute with his bishop in Alexandria in Egypt, and this thing just blew up in the church. Arius gathered a few followers, Eusebius of Caesarea, for example, and whose name will come up later on. And he was teaching basically that the Son is a creature. The Son is not eternal, he's a creature. And this led to the Council of Nicaea. Well, Arius died very early in the 4th century, and so and there weren't a lot of people who held strictly to what Arius as a man taught. Others took his views and tweaked them a little bit and went off in different directions. So you have several lines of development from the teaching of Arius the man. Athanasius, who we all know about, is one of the heroes of the early church, defender of Nicene Orthodoxy. He's debating all of these later followers of a somewhat Arian theology, no matter how they developed it. And rhetorically, he lumps them all together under the name Arianism, even though there's about three or four major strands of thought that aren't exactly the same in every respect. So sometimes when we look back at the 4th century and the Arian controversy, we can get the idea that there was this one group over here led by Athanasius, and they all held to the Nicene Creed and Nicene Orthodoxy, and then there was another group over here, the Arians, who all held to the same Arian doctrine. It was a lot more complicated than that, and we can't go into all the details. There's plenty of books out there that deal with this. But essentially, there was a tiny little group who held to Arius's own specific teaching, and then there were bigger groups over that period of time between 325 and 381, the Council of Nicaea and the Council of Constantinople, who held to various non-Nicene views that were neither Nicene nor, strictly speaking, following Arius himself. And we'll look at a few of these briefly, but let me just outline some of the main points of Arius's teaching. Arius taught that God was not always the Father. There was a time when he was simply God and not Father. So the Father is not eternally the Father. Why? Because the Son is not eternal. The Son came about, he was created. God made the Son out of non-existence. So he created the Son ex nihilo. And the Son, through the Son, created all other things. So the Son is a lesser level. Arius is still fine calling the Son God, but not in the same sense. You have to recall that during these early centuries of the church, it wasn't that uncommon it was a polytheistic culture, and there were various degrees of deity. So you could have, as in Gnosticism, one really high God, and then various lesser gods with a lowercase g. And so for Arius to call Jesus God didn't mean a whole lot. You could call all kinds of supreme beings God. When we hear the word God, we tend to think in terms of the one Christian God and the creator-creature distinction. And so thinking about these debates, we have to be careful to take ourselves and put ourselves back in this early church context, in a polytheistic context. So the Logos, the Son, is a creature. He's a God, lowercase God. He's a lesser deity, but he is a creature. He's a created God. God made him ex nihilo. Therefore, he cannot share the same nature as the Father. And here's where one of the technical terms that's important in the history of orthodoxy and heresy comes about. It's a Greek word spelled O-U-S-I-A, ousia. The Latin version, either substantia or essentia, essence or substance, is sometimes the Latin translation. But it's this Greek word ousia. And this will become important when you get to the Nicene Creed, which confesses that the Son is homoousios with the Father, of the same nature as the Father, having the same attributes as the Father. According to Arius, the Son does not have the same nature. He is not the same ousia, so he would be hetero, different ousia, hetero ousias from the Father, of a different nature, not deity. There are several powers in God that Arius distinguished between. There's an original logos that is immanent in God from all eternity. The Son was not immanent in the Godhead, but he was created, and he's given these kind of titles, logos or wisdom, loosely, not exactly. The Son only remains stable by the gift of God, so he's variable by nature, according to Arius. He was only unable to sin because God granted him this character of sinlessness in view of his foreseen merit. So God foresaw that the Son would be holy and merit, and so he granted him the ability to remain sinless. He wasn't by nature able to do that. So the Logos is different from the divine being. He's not true God because he has come into existence. He's not eternal. For Arius, the words begetting and created were identical and synonymous because both meant dependence. So he was fine saying the Son was begotten of the Father because that meant he was created of the Father. He was dependent on the Father and subordinate to the Father. The Son's knowledge of God is imperfect, according to Arius, and his knowledge of himself is imperfect. He was created for our sakes. The Son was created in order to create us. So we do have a trinity of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, but they are dissimilar. They are not alike. The Son is heteroousios from the Father. The Holy Spirit is heteroousios of a different nature, of a different being. It's a dissimilar trinity. The only union that exists that makes them a trinity, according to Arius, is a union of will. They share the same will because the Son and Spirit submit themselves to the Father. So Arius, when he hears the Nicene Creed and using this language of homoousios or consubstantial, both of which are saying that the Son is of the same nature as the Father, when he hears that, he thinks of it in a materialistic sense. If the Son is of the consubstantial with the Father, that means he's a broken off piece of the Father. He's thinking in very materialistic terms. So one of the reasons for Arius's teaching, why would he teach this about the Son? Part of it is because he believed that in order for our salvation to be accomplished, God had to suffer and die on the cross. Well, the Father can't do that because he is unable to suffer or die, so we had to have a lesser God, a God who is capable of suffering and dying. Therefore, we have the Son. The Son is brought in order to do these things that the true God cannot. He's inferior, and the incarnation makes him inferior. We will see that one of the key points of Arianism in all of its manifestations, all of the different developments of Arianism, the one thing they all have in common is this radical subordination, both ontological subordination, which means he's less in being, he's subordinate in being, but also functional subordination. Subordination of every kind is going on in the various forms of Arianism. We can see this, for example, in the Arian Creed written by Ulfilas, the Arian bishop of the Goths. Now, the Goths back then, they weren't kids who dress all in black and wear funny makeup, but the Goths who were part of the barbarian invasions of the Roman Empire. And Ulfilas was one of their bishops, and he writes this Arian Creed. And I just want to share this so you can get an idea of what it is they taught. I believe in one God, the Father, the only unbegotten and invisible, and in his only begotten Son, our Lord and God, the designer and maker of all creation, having none other like him, so that one alone among all beings is God the Father, who is also the God of our God. Notice how you can call both the Son and the Father God, but one's the God of the other God. So this one, you have a subordinate God. And in one Holy Spirit, the illuminating and sanctifying power. As Christ said after his resurrection to his apostles, "Behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but wait in the city of Jerusalem until you are clothed with power from on high," Luke 24:49. And again, "But you shall receive power when the Holy Ghost has come upon you." The Holy Spirit being neither God the Father nor our God Christ, but the minister of Christ, subject and obedient in all things to the Son, and the Son, subject and obedient in all things to God, who is his Father, whom he ordained in the Holy Spirit through his Christ. That was one of the earliest Arian creeds. You note how subordinationist it is. There are three gods, but they're different levels of God. And the Son is obedient and subordinate to the Father. The Spirit is obedient and subordinate to the Son. All of this carries forward in the various forms of Arianism. Let's look at one of those. One of the forms of Arianism that developed in between the Council of Nicaea in 325 and the Council of Constantinople in 381 was what is known as Homoian Arianism. This means like. The Son is like the Father. He's not homoousios, but he is like the Father because the Scripture says he's like him. He's not completely different. You don't see the word ousios in here because they hated that terminology. They thought this language of ousia and hypostasis, all these Greek terms borrowed from philosophy, are inappropriate when we're doing theology. We just want to use biblical terms. Homoian's not really a biblical term, but it's expressing the idea they don't like the ousia language. They think it's confusing. This theology, the Homoian theology, is derived from one of Arius's followers, Eusebius of Caesarea. He developed Arianism in a way, rejected some of Arius's own teachings and moved it in a slightly different direction. Homoian Arianism is represented by the second creed of Sirmium, which was written in 357, and a creed of Constantinople written in 360. The creed of Constantinople, the Homoian creed of Constantinople written in 360, was the official emperor-endorsed creed of the Christian church for about 20 years, from 360 to the Council of Constantinople in 381. This was why Jerome, the early church father Jerome, who translated the Vulgate, said the world woke up one day and found itself Arian. It's because Arianism, during this period of time between 325 and 381, it was a constant battle with these people. Not only the Homoians, but the next ones we'll look at. The second creed of Sirmium argued that the language homoousios, of like nature, of same nature, one essence, and the language of homoiousios, like in essence, should be avoided. The Father is greater than his subordinate Son. And you find language like this in the Second Sirmian Creed. There is no uncertainty about the Father being greater. It cannot be doubted by anyone that the Father is greater in honor, in dignity, in glory, in majesty, in the very name of Father. And if the Father is greater, the Son is lesser. If the Father is superior, the Son is inferior. And they were happy to confess that. And that was the government-endorsed creed in the church. They had a couple of main points I would just like to go through quickly. The incomparability of God the Father. So there's a subordination of the Son to the Father and the Spirit to the Son, as there was with Arianism. The Father is superior to the Son in every way. The Son is created from the Father's will. He's distinguished from the rest of creation because through him it was created. God the Father cannot suffer. God the Son can suffer and did suffer. The incarnation of the Son means a lesser divinity. This is why God the Son is inferior to the Father. So there's this dramatic and drastic subordinationism. And again, the Father and Son are united by will, not by nature. The Father is the Son's God, so the Son worships the Father. The Father worships no one. So ultimately, you just have a drastic form of subordinationism. Neo-Arianism is another development during these periods. It was taught by men like Aetius of Antioch and Eunomius of Cyzicus. It's sometimes known by the name Eunomianism. He's actually the most important Arian in this period of time between 325 and 381. Every one of the Cappadocian fathers wrote a book against Eunomius. Basil, Gregory of Nyssa, Gregory of Nacianzus, they're all writing against Eunomius. And this Neo-Arianism is a more modern way of describing the teaching of these two men. Sometimes this doctrine is referred to as anhomoian. We were just looking at Homoian Arianism, which means like. The Son is like. Anhomoian would mean unlike. It's not the best term to describe this because the Eunomians wouldn't say that the Son is unlike the Father in every way without some kind of qualification. Atheists taught that only an inferior God could become incarnate. The Logos, the eternal Logos, took the place of the soul in Jesus, so Jesus wasn't full and true man. They taught this doctrine that the Son is heteroousios, of a different being, a different nature. The name Father denotes the authority which produced the Son. God cannot beget, so they denied eternal generation. Eunomius has some strange things that he teaches on top of this. He argues that the Father is ingenerate. He was not generated. He's eternal, so he's incomparable. He cannot beget something which is generate, so there is no doctrine. He denies eternal generation. The Son, of course, is lesser, according to this view, and entirely subordinated to the Father. The Father does not share his glory or authority with the Son. The Son was created. He came into existence before creation by the will of the Father. So you have the creation of the Son, and then through the Son, the creation of everything else. Eternally obedient to the Father. He is less good and less real than the Father. One of the weird things, or weirder things, that Eunomius teaches is that God does not know more about his ousia, his being, his nature, than we do. What we know, he knows. What he knows, we know. And that's because these names convey direct knowledge of the essence of that which is named. So can't spend a lot of time on that. We only have a few minutes left. But there were differences between the Homoian Arians and Neo-Arians and Arius himself, and that needs to be kept in mind. The next major heresy we need to think about, and this is, as modalism is probably a popular view among evangelicals regarding the Trinity, Apollinarianism, I think, is fairly popular. I've run into it just talking to people about how they understand Christ. Apollinarius was very focused on the unity of Christ, a good thing, the oneness, but he didn't do well with other aspects. To save time, the main thing with Apollinarius is that the Logos, the Son, replaces the rational mind in Jesus. So Jesus has a body that's human, that's true human. He has an animal soul that is human, but the rational higher soul, the spirit that we all have as human beings, is replaced by the Logos. If any of you ever saw the 1990s or 2000s movie Men in Black, you might remember a scene where this alien's laying on a gurney in a morgue, and they pull his face off, and there's this tiny little alien behind his face and a little cockpit in his head. Apollinarianism is sort of Men in Black Christology, where Jesus is using the human body as this vehicle. So he's not truly man. He's only partly man. It's just a body. So Apollinarianism became a huge issue. One of my favorite theological terms of all time is this one. Pneumatomachianism, also known as Macedonianism, and we can't spend a lot of time on this. You get to the point where you finally have some people acknowledge, okay, the Father is homoousios, he's God, the Son is homoousios, he's God, the Spirit is not. So they are denying the deity and personality of the Spirit. And pneumatomachianism means spirit fighters, fighters against the Spirit. It was a term coined by Athanasius, I believe, in his letters on this subject. So you had those denying the deity of the Holy Spirit and his personality. The two-minute rundown on another major heresy in the early church is Pelagianism. Most of the ones we've looked at so far are either Trinitarian or Christological. This one is soteriological. This is Pelagius versus Augustine, one of the great conflicts in the early history of the church. His role in the controversy, Pelagius's role, caused this heresy to be known by his name. He was a monk from Great Britain. So he's trying to teach other monks to become spiritual, to become holy. And he's striving, he's pushing them to become holy. And he's fighting primarily against Manichaeanism, which we didn't discuss, but a very deterministic, dualistic view of the world. It was very fatalistic. Augustine also wrote against Manichaeanism, but he didn't go to the opposite extreme of Pelagianism. You didn't have this good and evil soul fighting with each other. Augustine had a statement that he wrote in his Confessions where he said, "Give what thou commands and command what thou will." And this was read by a bishop in the presence of Pelagius, and Pelagius blew a gasket and was just furious with that because he thought that kind of language gave an escape for the spiritually lazy monks, that they would say, well, I can't be holy because God hasn't given what he's commanded. So Pelagius fights back against this because he thought it made excuses for a failure to obey God. Basically, you can summarize Pelagius's thought under just a couple of headings. All of these, of course, we could develop in more detail, but grace is a natural facility, or at best, what happens at baptism, a cleansing from sin. Second, Adam's sin affected Adam. It didn't affect us. So he denies original sin. There is no impact of Adam's sin on us. No transmission of Adam's sin or guilt. And then finally, perfectionism. Pelagius believed by our own natural abilities we could live a life of sinful perfection. Augustine countered all of these, and this led to the Pelagian controversy, and Pelagius and his followers were condemned. Fifth century heresies. I'm only hitting the most important ones, by the way, and we're still having to go pretty fast on this. But when we get to the 5th century, this is where we get to more specifically Christological heresies, and I just want to mention a couple here. The first is Nestorianism. We have some of my students in here, and some of them have been in the Christology class, and they know that Nestorianism is incredibly complicated and very difficult to wrap your head around because he was less than the clearest writer. It's very obscure. It's also commonly mischaracterized. If you look in most modern theology textbooks, Nestorianism is described as the doctrine that teaches that Christ was two persons. Well, depending on how you define person, that might be accurate, but in our definition of person, that doesn't quite work. Nestorius' own views need a little bit more nuancing. He argued basically for a two sons doctrine. And this had been taught, and this was one of the doctrines that Apollinarius was so strongly against. Diodorus of Tarsus, back in the previous century, and his student Theodore of Mopsuestia, who was the teacher of Nestorius, they all taught this two sons doctrine. The Son of God is not the Son of Mary, and the Son of Mary is not the Son of God. You have to keep these two distinct. According to their view. And this is what Nestorius picked up on, this two sons idea. He is one, the Son of Mary is one thing and the Son of God is another. So you have one thing and another thing. If you've ever read the definition of Chalcedon, you know that at major points, at the very first sentence, in the very middle, and at the very end, you run into this phrase, one and the same. And then at half a dozen other times, the same. So it's one and the same, the same, the same, one and the same, the same. One and the same. And what they're getting at is this denial of two sons doctrine, that there are two sons in the scriptures. With Nestorius, if you look at him or Theodore describing what happened when Lazarus was raised, you have the Son of God, the Son of Mary walks to the grave of Lazarus and weeps, and then the Son of God raises Lazarus from the dead, and then the Son of Mary is back again and turns around. It's sort of a modalistic Christology in a way. It's a very strange doctrine. The two persons are connected by a moral unity. In one of Nestorius's sermons, he describes the union of the divine nature and the human nature in Christ in this way. He says, it's like a man who has fallen down and another man reaches down to pick him up and holds him tight. This is how, and Nestorius says, this is how you are to think of the union of the divine and human in Christ. In other words, his theory of the union of the divine nature and human nature is a big bear hug. That's not adequate to deal with how the natures are united in the person of Christ. And Nestorius caused an enormous controversy by following up on this thing. This was why the definition of Chalcedon ultimately came along. Now, in some of his writings, Nestorius has a more precise definition of his theory of how the divine and human are united. And I like to use this illustration. Actually contacted two world-class patristic scholars to ask them if this illustration of Nestorianism was accurate or not, and both of them said yes, so I feel better about this. But on his better days, Nestorius used the idea, he used the Greek term prosopon, which in the older language meant the face, the outward observance that somebody sees. So you see my face, you see my appearance, and you know that I'm a human being. You know that my nature, my ousia, is that of a human being. So Nestorius said, the way we describe the union in Christ is that we have these two prosopon united in one prosopon. So you have in Scripture, you only see this one face that's presented. It's the one Jesus that's walking around. But sometimes it's the Son of Mary. Sometimes it's the Son of God. You can see why it's confusing when he's using the same word to describe both the oneness and that which is two in Jesus. So if you've seen this optical illusion before, you know if you look at it in one way, the old lady's face is apparent, and in another way, a younger lady's face is apparent. You know, in the old lady's face, this is her nose and her mouth and her fur shawl and her eyes, and she's looking towards us down that way. The younger lady, this is her jawbone and her eyelash and her nose, and she's looking away. This is sort of what's going on with Nestorius when he describes Scripture. You have one drawing, one prosopon of the drawing, but depending on where you are in Scripture, sometimes you're seeing the young lady, the Son of Mary, sometimes you're seeing the old lady, the Son of God, but it's all this one image that we're looking at. That's Nestorius' own way of describing it. It's very confusing. This is the easiest way I can illustrate what's going on. But what it amounts to is that on his worst day, the union is a hug. On his best day, Jesus is an optical illusion. And so in either case, Nestorius is problematic. Last one I want to look at is Eutyches and the Monophysites. One thing to keep in mind is sometimes these terms are used synonymously, but it's not quite accurate. All Eutychians would be Monophysites, but not all Monophysites were Eutychians. Eutyches teaches that he's emphasizing the opposite of Nestorius. Nestorius is emphasizing the duality. Eutyches is emphasizing the oneness. But the way he describes the oneness is that the divine nature and the human nature are blended or mixed into this one new thing that's neither truly God nor truly man, but some new third type of being. Some Monophysites after Eutyches followed that idea, but not all of them. There were different ways of expressing the Monophysite view. Some of them seem to just to be trying to preserve an earlier definition of the word nature, which is found here, you know, phusis, one nature, one phusis. And that word, like every other word in the Trinitarian and Christological debates, evolved in its meaning over time. Ousia, hypostasis, phusis, prosopon, all these Greek terms were evolving in their meaning. At the time of Council of Nicaea in 325, words like ousia and hypostasis were used basically synonymously. By the time you get to the Council of Constantinople in 381, they're the technical terms that describe that which is one. There's one ousia, three hypostases, so one being, three persons. But they're evolving at different rates in different parts of the empire. So you have sometimes people talking past each other when they're using the very same terms. This, again, is addressed in the Chalcedonian definition. You recall one of the major sections of the definition of Chalcedon, that with Jesus Christ, we have one person and two natures, and the two natures are united without... You remember, if you've listened to Dr. Sproul over the years, you know the four adverbs. The two natures are united without mixture or confusion, a denial of this, without separation or division, a denial of Nestorianism. So when you look at the Nicene Creed or the definition of Chalcedon, they're written in the context of all these versions of Arianism and Apollinarianism. So that's the background and context within which their language should be read. When you read the Nicene Creed, say he's begotten, not made, unlike Arius, they're distinguishing between begotten and made. He is eternally begotten. He's not a creature, not made. And the same with the definition of Chalcedon. Learning from heresy. I think when we study the history of heresy, it's important because if you don't learn from the mistakes of the past, you're going to repeat them. And we see that in the church even today. Every one of these heresies still exists in the church today because we haven't learned from the mistakes of the past. It's also important, for what I was just saying, understanding the context of the Nicene Creed and the definition of Chalcedon. If you're Reformed, or whether Reformed Baptist or Luther or Presbyterian or Lutheran or Anglican or whatever, these creeds are part of your confessional heritage. If you're a Westminster person, it teaches Nicene Trinitarianism and Chalcedonian Christology. You need to understand what those are. And looking at these heresies, I believe, can contribute to that. And it's not pleasant to be talking continually about views that are derogatory, I believe, about Christ and is basically blasphemous. But we have to be on guard against this. The enemy is subtle and comes at us in a number of ways. Being familiar with your with your enemy is a helpful way of guarding against it. So thank you for your attention. Thank you for being attentive for a 500 mile an hour flyby of 500 years of church history. I hope you enjoy the rest of the conference.